बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट्स, फेलो इंजीनियर्स, आर्किटेक्ट्स एंड टाउन प्लानर्स, इट्स अ मैटर ऑफ ग्रेट ऑनर फॉर मी टू डिलीवर माय लेक्चर हियर टू दिस ऑगस्ट गैदरिंग। आई विल डिस्कस द यूज ऑफ रीइंफोर्स्ड अर्थ फॉर लैंडस्लाइड कंट्रोल। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल I would say that this new reinforced earth technology, which is developed to new heights, has its roots in some rudimentary concepts which were present even in the prehistoric era. So there are different usages of this reinforced technology in civil engineering, ranging from its use for landslide control to slope stabilization to foundation system strengthening to roadways and railways and underground works and so many others. So here I'll present a brief discussion on the landslide phenomenon, because Pakistan's northern part is plagued with the landslide issues in different geological formations, and then some discussion about landslide hazard index and slopes and landslides, how landslides occur on slopes, what is the relationship, the types of landslides. It's not only one type, there are different types for which different measures would be needed, and general remedial measures which are in place in Pakistan at the moment. Then concepts and mechanics of reinforced earth, their applications, types of the systems which are available for landslide control, and in the end I'll give a case history about its use at a project at Jhika Gali where landsliding had taken place, followed by conclusions and recommendations. And here you see that in this diagram, you can see in this block different types of landslides taking place. They're shown varying from rock slides to translational modes to debris flow with high moisture content, and you can see submarine landslide also, some rock falls. So there are a variety of types. Basically, it is the downward movement of soils and rocks when they become unstable under gravity, and that is landslide. The results are colossal, could be a lot of damage to the property and to the human life. There are several causative factors, and mitigation measures have to be in accordance with the factors which trigger the landslides. And there is not a one generic solution to tackle all landslides. All the measures only reduce the risk, they don't eliminate the risk in totality. And there are several possible solutions for tackling the landslide issue at a particular site. And here you see one famous disaster, landslide problem at Atabad, which was a lot of movement of debris from the mountain sliding down into Hunza River back in 2010. And a lake was formed, and then some remediation was done and tunnels have been constructed. We know that all those who have traveled around Karakoram Highway, that there are peculiar landslide issues in long stretches. And in 2005, October 8, 2005, northern part of Pakistan was shaken by a big earthquake. And here is one picture of landslide material moving along, which has moved along the slope, blocking the roadway, damaging it. And there are other rampant problems in Mari area where the landslide issues are different, the triggering factors are different. There are soft rocks with some soft soil deposits which overlie the soft rocks. So some landslides which are being remedied even now at Devil. And here you see some views of the landslides in the world, like in Taiwan, a famous freeway number 3 landslide. You can see that so many roads have been just damaged, they've gone away. And a Bitter Springs landslide in Arizona, you can see the condition of the roads here, the whole mass moved down. Here, this is a fatality index globally developed to tell about the landslide. And here you see in Pakistan, the inset in the green square, you can see that the northern part of Pakistan has a lot of landsliding issues. And this landsliding belt goes into the mountainous part of India, China, Nepal, you can see. They all share almost similar geological formations. And here you see, there's a list in this histogram of about 20 countries. This is the data from 2006 up to 2008. Number of fatal or major landslides. And you can see, although area of Pakistan is small compared to India, China, but you can see that we rank 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, number 6 in this global landslide fatality map. So we have this issue. Slope stability is an old age issue, and every time we learn lesson, we become wiser, but sometimes, you see, new kinds of mechanism, they come into being, and we are still in the process of learning. There is a natural instability in slopes in many areas, and they are triggered when the balance is disturbed. There could be natural causes or there could be man-made causes like excavations, uncontrolled excavations, and inadequate understanding of the mechanisms. And now there is a demand with the improvement in technology that the landslide issues be remedied in a proper scientific way. Main manifestations, the trapped seepage water in the pores of soils. This is because of the absence of effective surface and subsurface drainage systems, or if they are present, they are not operating properly. This is one important thing. And second is the excessive movements or deformations. And there could be various reasons. This could be, one reason could be increase of weight on the upper part of the slope, the earthquake activity, the horizontal thrust application, and low shearing resistance of the soils which form slope because of excessive water content in them. Here again you can see a view of landslides ranging from rotational to translational, moving along one planar surface, block slides, rock falls, toppling, debris flow, and avalanche, debris avalanche with speeds are very high, earth flows, creep, which is a gradual phenomenon. In Murray and Kohala area, at many places, creeping, gradual creeping, which is indicated by some twisting of the trees and some bad land formation that is very evident there. And there are lateral spreads also on very flat slopes. General remedial measures which are conceived, they can be flattening the slope by excavation to make it more stable, or removing the weight from the head, or providing drainage system along with flattening of the slope and using a restraint as the berm to stop the sliding tendency. Provision of in-situ drains and chimney blanket drains in many forms, that is a very effective measure. And in Pakistan, majority of the landslides have been tackled in a semi-scientific way, I would say, without proper study. People have been experimenting, providing gabions in the wire baskets, stones are put with wide end of bases, but care is sometimes not taken whether the whole system, which is heavyweight gravity system, rests on stable foundations or not. So they keep on sliding. Similarly, masonry retaining walls are also used. You can see in the views, use of stone gabions, like one famous Kashmiri Bazaar landslide, it has been remedied with the construction of stone masonry walls. In this typical section, you can see that on the left side, there's mountain and an RC or a masonry wall is provided there along with retaining walls to contain the sliding activity. And then the purveyor of road is made by providing fill, which is supported again on piles with a retaining wall, with RC retaining wall. So this is a kind of composite system. Sometimes this system has to work. Here you see typical stone masonry retaining walls in our northern areas, especially in Murray and Kohala. We can see they are there to contain small sliding activities along with V-poles, which are there to drain the pore water pressure and to maintain the stability of the areas. And here at Jhika Gali, in the lower parts of the slopes, a curved masonry arch type structure. This is also a mayor, which is given in our northern areas sometimes. And when you travel along the Islamabad Murray dual carriageway, you come across many reinforced concrete retaining walls with V-poles at a number of places. So these have been the typical uses, and in addition, some other general measures, purveying of piles at the toe, so that any incipient slipping tendency, the sliding tendency, that is intercepted readily by piles. And you can see in the lower diagram a geosynthetic use to contain the slipping surface so as to improve the strength. And here you see a deep anchor. We can see that in USA there is a notorious devil's landslide in California, which has been stabilized with the very deep anchors, like 150 feet deep anchors. And here you see the anchored retention system, anchored reinforced slopes. Anchors are in fact deep members. Sometimes only shallow containment is required, and for that purpose nails are used, which are up to 5 to 10 meters in length in total. And this is called nail reinforcement. This is also in use in many parts of the world, and a view of the nail reinforcement. Now, just discussing you that one French highway architect and engineer, he was highway engineer and architect, Henry Vidal, back in 1957, when he was building, as it is quoted, a sand castle on a beach, he discovered that it is failing again and again. So he struck with the idea of using pine needles in the sand to make it stable. So this is said to be, it as it is mentioned in the whole literature, it led to the development of the modern reinforced earth systems. So that is the concept. The concept is not new, as I've told you. It is very old, and in the ancient times, if you go back, Baghdad 1,000 years before Christ, brick and with straws and woven mats have been used in Agar Kof Ziggurat, the massive tombs, which are step tombs. It has been used to stabilize those, and in the sanctuaries in Babylon, that some parts of the Great Wall of China, which were constructed back in 2000 before Christ, have some reinforcement with some special shrub, tamarisk branches. Romans have been using and constructing earthen levees for protection against floods along River Tiber. And in England, the River Thames still contains in places some remnant signs of old timber buried for reinforcement purpose. So the rudimentary concept has been there. Now, reinforced earth is a combination of earth and linear reinforcing strips of steel or different polymer material like polyethylene, polypropylene or polyesters that are capable of bearing large tensile stresses. Hence, it is also called mechanically stabilized earth. The reinforcement provided by these strips will enable the mass to resist tension in a way which the earth alone could not. So this is the basic mechanism. If we look at how does this compare, reinforced earth compare with reinforced concrete, which we are very familiar, reinforced earth is somewhat analogous. In both the materials, in both the compositums, reinforcement develops tensile stresses generally by friction with soil in the former and by bond with concrete in the latter. Soil or concrete would develop compressive stresses. And the basic aim in both the materials is to contain the deformations, the movements, to make them stronger. Materials which are used in reinforced earth would be generally three: soil or fill, which is used to develop friction along the reinforcing elements, which are strips, metallic or polymeric, and the facing elements, which range from concrete to eco-friendly green grass type materials also. And the stability requirements are, of course, that the system remains internally stable. The system which is tied up with the metal or polymeric bands and remains externally stable. There is no sliding, there is no excessive translational movements. And here you see a block of reinforced earth. Horizontal black lines indicate the strips, and they develop tension. And in the dashed line, you can also see the conventional retaining wall, and this is how you can see serving the same purpose. Here another view of similar mechanically stabilized earth. Now let's have a brief look at the major advantages which we consider we get from reinforced earth system. Primarily for high walls, there is a marked reduction in cost. The construction is easy and there is simplicity of construction. Since the materials, they are already, ready-made, strips, the facing elements, so control over quality is good, and it is assembled and constructed quickly, saves a lot of time. The materials are durable and such systems have long life. They are more flexible against sliding and can accommodate small movements, and sometimes they undergo elastic deformation which is recovered back. So very good for use in earthquake areas. Option to work as a self-draining structure when we use such material which are self-draining, which are coarse grain material to develop friction, the system becomes self-draining. Then construction is possible on steep slopes. In place of going on flat slopes and using a lot of material, we can save with reinforcer to make construction on steep slopes, and has a lot of promise to be used in the limited spaces where space limitation is there. So as I've told earlier, there's a wide application ranging from landslides to roadways, railways, retention walls, foundations, bridge abutments. We have seen the use in bridge abutments in many cities in Pakistan. Dams and embankments to strengthen them. Terracing for roads and housing on slopes, when we have to go for a terraced structure, for stabilizing the bedding and the ambience, the sides of the pipeline excavations. Industrial and military uses been widely used, sea wall, river walls and canal walls. Similarly, underground structures and where space limitation is there. So we see that there's a lot of promise of using this technology. Here in the top right side, you see that the reinforcing elements present in the form of geosynthetic grid that is used and tied with the facing element, which appears to be concrete in front and is held back, anchored back. So this is how this simple system in layers is constructed. Here you see in layers use of geotextile. In layers, here you see geogrid used in slopes for earth reinforcement, and here a wide application for stabilizing the slope. There has been an application of use of these reinforced earth and geotextile materials to work as the water force breaking materials in place of riprap too. And now I'll be just giving you a brief account of landslide case history where sliding had taken place at Jhika Gali Junction and how reinforced earth has been used to stabilize it. So just skip this. Earth stabilization has been a special promise, and these are general comments. Reinforced earth is used worldwide for stabilization of landslide prone areas, and Jhika Gali has been the first application of reinforced earth to control landslide in Pakistan. The design considers every kind of internal, external stability in very difficult ambience conditions like heavy rainfalls and earthquakes and soft slopes having creeping tendency. So in Mari, what kind of general stratigraphy is there? That there are soft rocks, and above the soft rocks are soft colluviums. So we see that generally the movements are there in the slopes, but generally they are in the upper softer soil, colluvium or overburden material, and they become pronounced and become mobile sometimes during heavy rainfall because of poor drainage, deforestation activity, and due to high seismicity. So we consider that such areas are quasi-stable. They are just present at low safety factor on the threshold of stability. If any man-made or construction or excavation activity is carried out unscrupulously with little less care, then the results are devastating. So back in 2009, original planning was to construct a plaza there on a steep slope, and slope was fairly deep, about 100 feet or slightly more than that in the valley. And in 2010, the activity had started hardly when there were spells of heavy rainfall. And at two places, it's in the next figure I will show you, it's an L-shaped junction, and at two places, on the two limbs, some sliding took place. So this required that some immediate stabilization measures be planned. And here you see that one is called landslide 1 on the road which leads to Kuldana, and the other is called landslide 2 on the road which leads from junction to Burwan. The gray color of road indicates the existing road network, and the pink additional road work is to the widening planned road. So at these two places, so you can see one temporary bridge, Bailey Bridge, was constructed, and here you see before occurrence of landslide on the Kuldana roadside, you can see that this was a natural view of slope, and after sliding had taken place, this was the view. This is the bad view after sliding, in which part of the road came down. And on the other side, on the Burwan roadside, this is the view. You can see grass and trees. But after sliding had taken place, this assumed this kind of shape. And this is one bridge, Bailey Bridge, temporarily constructed on three piers to take the traffic load for some time. So in this case history, I will also tell you that detailed, rigorous geological and geotechnical studies were carried out to understand the behaviors of rocks. Instrumentation was done by different modes, and a lot of laboratory testing was carried out, and here you can see that those test locations have been marked. Now, briefly, that what is the stratigraphy present there on the slopes? That 3 to 9 meters of almost soft to firm, reddish brown clay soil with or without gravel. That was present, and it was underlain by a weathered shale rock, 3 to 5 meters, and beneath that weathered shale was present unweathered or slightly weathered shale with some intermittent sandstone bedding. This is a very typical stratigraphic sequence in Murray. So what has been, efforts were done, geotechnical parameters were derived by approach called back analysis, in which from the failure surface, which is a possible, kinematically possible failure surface, one finds out that what parameters will control if the failure would take place for a safety factor of one. Then laboratory tests and other measurements, and you can see that for the analysis, overburdened soil and weathered shales, they have fairly low shearing strength parameters, zero cohesion and angle of internal friction of 25 to 27 degrees. And the soil parameters improve for the unweathered rock, but even that is not very strong. Murray falls in zone 3 as per the zoning map of Pakistan, earthquake zoning map. And for analysis for this zone 3, average acceleration of 0.2 g was adopted. Now, several options were considered for slope stabilization. One is the cutting of an existing slope to flatter slope, providing soil nails. Three, providing deep anchors, or providing unreinforced huge mass of earth after compaction, or providing reinforced compacted earth fill fully or partly. Cutting or benching option was totally ruled out because it would increase the risk of triggering more landslide by excessive excavations and would pose a lot of safety hazard. Soil nailing was considered not to be a viable option because it is to stabilize only shallow failures, not for deep failures, and it would also involve serious construction difficulties. Deep pile anchor system uses sophisticated technology, and it requires special equipment for making very deep anchors and piles, and costs would have been astronomical and in addition to time, so this was ruled out. So fourth option was whether to use an earthen embankment unreinforced. What about that? So that was considered to be unsafe, but to save cost, it was considered that reinforced compacted earth fill, not in the full embankment but in the upper part, that would be the best option to save the road too. So
comparison
here
is,
you see,
between
option
1,
2, 3, 4 are good. Now this is the general configuration. Here you see the slopes, the white, the green and the blue sloping lines indicate sandstone ribs, and then there's a pink zone, thin pink band indicating weathered shale, and the overburdened mass has been removed, and the gray is the zone of the earthen material which was supposed to be placed for stabilizing the slope. Now, if the slope is unreinforced and it is made at an angle of 1 vertical to 1.75 horizontal, and in lieu, if its upper portion is reinforced, as you can see, with horizontal black bands, and slope is steepened to 1 vertical to 1.25 horizontal, then stability analysis were ran. And here, in the summary, you can see the result, comparison of the results. The first two serial numbers, compacted fill without reinforcement, and second is also without reinforcement, but first one is on 1:1.5 slope and the 1:1.75. Then on a steeper slope, third one, compacted fill with reinforced earth. So the comparison shows that steepening the slope, saving the material, but making the upper part strong so that the road remains functional for long durations in this high earthquake zone, the safety factors in static condition and in earthquake condition by pseudo-static analysis, they are reasonable. 1.5 under static condition and 1.1 under earthquake condition of zone 3. So this is how it was selected that reinforced earth system is appropriate. And the above considerations reveal that option 5, the last one with partial reinforcement of the upper part of the slope, was the best option, and it was adopted. But it was not the end. Then there are there's a variety of different products, different patents of reinforced earth. So at that time, two famous groups, Tensar, have a worldwide presence, and Fresenius Group have a worldwide presence. Former uses high density polyethylene, and the latter uses high tenacity polyester tendons. So their comparisons were made, technical comparison on the basis of material strength, the durability, how much in their condition would be in long life, how flexible the system would be against earthquake forces, environmental factors, their chemical compositions, and their life, worldwide experience, and and the costs involved. And ultimately, both the systems have been used in the world, but for this, the Fresenius-based system was used. Then three different products of Fresenius were studied for this use. All provide the landslide control systems of reinforced earth, but they are slightly different. Terratrel, F2, Paragrid, and Fresisol. So here you see Terratrel T2. Here this uses about 3 inches wide polypropylene belts with impregnated polyester tendons, which are as strong as steel. Then the facing element will be green, as you see in the last picture. And this is during the laying operation. Then second is a Paragrid system, which normally uses a grid laid in layers. And third one is a Fresisol, which uses a different system for its belt. So out of these three, Terratrel F2 was considered as the best to give an eco-friendly look, as well as to give long life and durability and strength. And here in the plan, you can see black outline of the sloped surfaces. And in this section, you see the upper reinforced part and lower unreinforced part with a few benches also on the constructed slope. So in addition to providing earth reinforced systems, any system which provides stability to the slopes, this is also requires providing efficient, very good, properly functioning drainage system, which has to be maintained during the lifetime of the works. So efficient surface and subsurface drainage systems, drainage wells, drainage matrices under the reinforced earth, where it interfaces with the natural rock, and horizontal drainage holes. In this, you can see the red holes, the red dashed lines, this one, this indicates the horizontal drainage holes, which are capable to draw water, moisture, seepage water from within the slope and to drain it out. Similarly, provision of toe drains. Now it was also considered that where the toe will be, the toe has to be strong enough. So a special consideration was made that how to construct strong toe, because if the toe is strong, then the foundation is strong, then that becomes a restraint against movement. So you can see a stepped approach is indicated here, whereby partial excavations going up to the weathered rock or compact soil. You can see this is how a sequence in which the toe was provided, partly resting on stronger formation. Now you see construction of reinforced earth with Terratrel F2 system at site. In the step one, you see in front of the slope cohesive material or sweet soil which would grow grass, and in front of that is a grid of metal, and between that sweet soil and metal is laid a geotextile cloth. In step two, you can see from the crowbars are tied those 3 inches wide polyethylene and polyester belts, which are hooked in the step three. You can see on the left side, they are hooked at the back, and this is how they run in layers. Belts are laid, granular material is placed in one layer, compacted properly, then a layer of second belts, material laid, and similarly so on and so forth, and slope is constructed in stages. So here you can see a constructed view of the reinforced earth on the Koldena end, and a beautiful view how it looked after snowfall. And this is during the partial growth of grass on the Bhurbar end. Ultimately, it will become entirely green and it will give a natural, eco-friendly look, and widening of the road on the top. Now, I just wrap it up, just conclude that we have experienced that as is used in the world, reinforced earth is a good option for stabilization of landslide. And there's a lot of room available for using this technology in the northern parts of Pakistan. But one has to determine the causes of landslide, and one has to give a solution and to design such different systems accordingly. In the unstable areas, improvement of drainage has also to be made. It's not that we provide reinforced earth in isolation. A lot of surface and subsurface improvement has to be done. Otherwise, the system may fail again. And a message to the local construction industry that so far, such systems are imported. And this is not a rocket science. They are simple technologies. I feel that local industry should develop such systems, design and manufacture of reinforced earth systems. And if this is done so, this product will become very economical, cheap, and can be applied to a number of places in our northern areas to stabilize the slopes. Thank you very much.